Welcome to the Forest Park Seventh-day Adventist Church, a vibrant, diverse, growing, and friendly community of faith located in Everett, Washington, blending traditional and contemporary elements to create a weekly opportunity to worship our Creator God. Now, please find a quiet and comfortable place to sit and enjoy this worship hour with the Forest Park Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Glad that everyone's here today. Have a few announcements to start off. One of the announcements didn't quite make it in the bulletin. On
December 3rd, there's going to be a memorial service here for Betty's mother. If you want to attend that, it's on the 3rd. Milton, where is Milton sitting? If you want to stand up, there he is. Milton is going to be taking pictures of folks if you want to have your picture in the church directory.
So now you know who to look for. Thank you, Milton. We just want to encourage everybody. The directory, when you want to get in the directory, then you have access to the directory. So talk to John Anholm, and he can get you access, and Milton can take your picture. And it helps, our congregation is growing. It definitely helps to be able to see names and faces and help you remember as we're growing, right? So thank you, Milton. And then also today after the service, the potluck crew is going to have a quick meeting. So it'll be nice. We're going to be having potlucks again soon. So amen to that. And then also, this week, there was not a prayer meeting due to Thanksgiving holiday, but there is going to be again next week. So just want to remind folks of that. Shirley, 85 years. So congratulations. Just yesterday, and the flowers are here as a gift from her daughters. So amen. Amen. So, all right, pastor's coming up with the last announcement.
All right, good morning. I'd like to invite Kent Caldwell up here, and you all have heard a little bit about the announcement that we were doing a community cleanup ministry, and I just can't, I'll have you use the pulpit mic here, but I just wanted to get an update from you. You guys did your first community cleanup last Sunday. Here's a picture of those who showed up, plus there was one more behind the camera, I believe. And I'm not going to try to name everyone because I'm certain I will forget a name here on the spot, but that is the crew that was there. So could you give us a little bit of an update about how things went doing the community cleanup?
Yeah, I thought it went great, and God blessed us with some good weather. We had 5 people show up, and we picked up 15 bags of garbage, which was quite a bit for just a 7-block area. So I thought that was kind of neat.
Where did you guys pick up trash?
That was on Broadway, just from Everett Street to 19th Street. So I think there was about 7 blocks there.
Wow. And when is the next opportunity to participate in this ministry?
I think it's the weekend before Christmas. I'd have to look at my calendar, but I'm shooting for the 3rd weekend in December. Avoiding the holiday, so it's the weekend before. And it'll be Forest Park this time. We're going to go up to the park.
All right, so it sounds like December 19 will be the next opportunity.
And we'll try and get that in the bulletin, too.
Yeah, and so thank you so much, Kent, for doing this. Just so that you know kind of how things work and how I approach ministry opportunities like this, if someone has a ministry idea, typically a ministry needs a ministry champion. So someone approached us with the idea of, can we do this? I've got all this, all this stuff, resources to go and do this. I have a passion for doing it. Can we do it? And I said, we need a ministry champion. He said, well, ask the congregation and find out. So I got up here and I asked. Actually, it was at prayer meeting that I asked. And Kent was like, Yep, that one's me. I'm the ministry champion for that. And absolutely, we're just trying to enable and make it possible to do a ministry. So if you have any other creative community outreach sorts of ministries, we just need a workable plan and a ministry champion, and we will get behind it. So and if you have any ideas like that, let me know. Thank you so much. Musicians, I think you're on.
Morning, everyone. Another happy Sabbath day. Welcome to each and every one of you. How many of you celebrated the Thanksgiving holiday the other day? How many of you are really, truly thankful that we're here? I see all the hands thing. Well, I am. I never, ever dreamed I'd live to 85, and but I did, I have, and God is good, and God blesses us. And he helps us each and every day, helps us with little tiny problems and large problems, and he just gets us there, and he's gonna get us there, each one of you. So do I stand here or over there now? This is, I haven't been up here for many years, but. Okay. Us older people need younger people to tell us what to do and help us with our lives. So should I stand here?
Yeah, you can stand there.
It's okay. Fine. Well, we have this song, the first one that we're going to sing here is Come Ye Thankful People. And I know now all of you raised your hands. You're all thankful. So let's sing. Jesus loves to hear us sing. He really, really loves to hear us sing all the time. And sometimes it can be hard, a little hard to sing when you're going through trials and losses like a lot of us are. But this is, we're going to sing all four verses. It's four verses. We're going to sing all four verses. And let's make the roof raise here with our thankfulness to Jesus. Isn't he the person that you're most thankful to?
Amen.
With him, we live, move, and have our being. Without him, nothing. We need Jesus. Come, ye thankful people.
Gathered in
you bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we come here before you today to worship you and thank you for all the blessings that you've given us throughout this year and throughout this week and throughout today. We ask that your Holy Spirit would be here with us and with our pastor as he delivers your words to us today, that we may hear them and grow in our relationships with you. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm so looking forward to Jesus coming. Can I see all the hands of those that are as anxious as I am? Yes, and Jesus is, and God is anxious too. I can't wait to see him break through that eastern sky in all his glory. And who will then dare doubt that he is not King of Kings and Lord of Lords and Creator of all, our wonderful Jesus? We're going to sing now for the beauty of the earth. Our world is a beautiful place, and the flowers and the trees and all those things, we can look at them and know for sure that God is the creator, no doubt. For the beauty of the earth. We'll sing all three stanzas again. I haven't rehearsed it. Now we're going to sing Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart, and all of us can rejoice in that because Jesus has us covered. He has our back, and he has us covered with his wonderful, perfect righteousness. The life he lived and the life he died is ours, and how many of you believe that? Everybody, thank you. Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart. So let's sing like we really, really, really are praising our wonderful Savior.
Rejoice, give thanks and sing.
I was number five of eight children, number five, and I was born on Thanksgiving Day. I was born on Thanksgiving Day. And I know my mother was thankful that I was born. I'm sure I was the fifth, the eighth, so she had three more after me, all precious. So we just are so thankful. What a gift life is. Life is. 85 years, you know, is nothing to what we're going to live when Jesus comes. Think about it. Eternity. We have eternity ahead of us. And so we're going to rejoice here until we get there to our eternal life. What was that? Oh, okay. I'm learning. We're done for now.
All right, that brings us to the time in our service where we have our offering. And today, the story to go along with it was about a young man. He approached his pastor and said, "Pastor, I'm feeling like I need to become a pastor. That is what I believe God wants me to do with my life. What is the next step?" And the pastor said, "Well, you know, there's a lot of learning, so you probably want to go to college." So this young man jumped in his car, and he drove to the school when it was time of the year, you know, in the fall when classes were going to be starting. And he arrived, and he, you know, went to sign up, and the admissions office sent him to the financial aid office. And the officer there said, "Well, how much money do you have to contribute, you know, to your tuition?" And he emptied his pockets and said, "This little bit of change that I have is all I got. I used the rest of my money for the gas to get here." And the financial aid person said, give me a minute. And she stepped away. She made a few phone calls. And she came back and told him that a few days ago, an anonymous donor had come into her office, given her his phone number, and said, "If somebody comes in and says they have the desire to be a pastor and they do not have the finances, call me." So this young man, he in 1982, went to college and became a minister for God. God takes care of his people. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end." Amen. Would the ushers please step forward? Oops. Yeah, I don't have any jokes that good. They're all dad jokes with five kids. Well, I guess maybe while we're waiting, we'll just have the prayer. And then once she gets here, we can start having the folks pick it up. So if you bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we come here before you today, thanking you for everything you've done for us and asking that you'd be with us and with the offerings that we give today, so that we can be a blessing to others like you have been to us. We thank you, and we ask these things in your holy and precious name. Amen. have Lynn coming up to do our scripture reading, too.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our scripture reading this morning is Revelation 1, 10 through 18. It was the Lord's day, and I was worshiping in the Spirit. Suddenly, I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet blast. It said, write in a book everything you see and send it to the seven churches in the cities of Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. When I turned to see who was speaking to me, I saw seven gold lampstands, and standing in the middle of the lampstands was someone like the Son of Man. He was wearing a long robe with a gold sash across his chest. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like flames of fire. His feet were like polished bronze refined in a furnace, and his voice thundered like mighty ocean waves. He held seven stars in his right hand, and a sharp two-edged sword came from his mouth. And his face was like the sun in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as if I were dead. But he laid his right hand on me and said, don't be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I died, but look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and the grave.
Now is time for prayer, so if you can, please kneel with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we're here kneeling before you today, here to worship you, here to worship the seventh day, the Sabbath that you've made for us. We thank you for everything. In this time of the year with Thanksgiving, we think about, maybe more often than we do the rest of the year, all of the things that you've given us and blessed us with. And we think about those that we've lost. We think about our year, and we just ask that you would be with all of us, continue to guide us, to continue to keep our hearts and minds safe. And we ask that you'd be with those who couldn't be here, and help them in whatever way they may need it. And we ask that you'd be here in our presence today and help us to hear your words and your guidance. And we ask that the funds that we've provided would be a blessing. We ask that you'd continue to bless us, because we know that the funds that we gave came from you originally, as everything that we have has come from you. Yeah. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Little ones would like to come on down. Kendra has a children's story for us.
Good morning, boys and girls. Have you heard today somebody had a birthday? Can you guys help me with something? Can we sing happy birthday to Grandma Shirley over there? You guys help me? Ready? Your sister too, okay. Ready, let's go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Shirley. Happy birthday to you. Yay. Amen. Okay. Thank you, guys. You just sing so good. So, who can tell me what they want to be when they grow up? Danny.
Designer.
Kelsey, a hair stylist.
Hair stylist. Oh, hairstylist.
I want to be the same as Kelsey. I'm a hairstylist.
Oh, the same as Kelsey. Be a hairstylist. Wow, how about you?
A doctor.
A doctor? All right. Well, our story today is about three trees, okay? And they wanted to be something when they grow up. The first tree, she said, when I grow up, I want to be made into a beautiful, beautiful treasure chest. I want to have gold on me and jewels so I can be some nice gift for some king, okay? The second tree said, when I grow up, I want to sail the mighty ocean, sail the waves, and carry the mighty kings. And the third little tree, she said, you know, when I grow up, I want to stay here on top of the mountaintop so I can grow tall and reach to the sky, and when people look at me, they can think of God. So many, many years went by, the rain came, the sunshine came, and the three trees, they grew big and big and tall. Well, one day, three men, they came and they were coming up the mountain with their axes, because they're gonna cut trees down, right? Okay, and the first man looks at the first tree and says, you know, this tree will be perfect for me. So with a swoop of his axe, we swing our axes. Boom, the first tree fell down. And she's like, oh, I'm excited. I'm gonna be made into a treasure chest. Do you think she's gonna be a treasure chest? No, maybe? Okay, well then the second man, he looks at the second tree and says, you know, this tree will be perfect for me. So with a swoop of his axe, whoosh, whoosh, boom. The second tree fell to the ground, and she got all excited. Oh, I'm going to be made into this great big ship and sail across the mighty seas. Do you think so?
No?
And the third man, he looked at his axe, he says, any tree will do for me. So he looks at that third tall tree, who all she wanted to do is reach the heavens. And he took his axe, swoosh, swoosh, poof, and the third tree fell. And the three men, they carried their trees back down the mountain into the little town. Now the first tree, when her carpenter took her home, she did not become a treasure chest. She was so disappointed. Would that be sad? Yeah. Well, but she became something else. She cried and complained about it. She says, all I am is a box covered with sawdust and filled with hay, and I've been stuck in a barn with these animals. But one day, long, long time ago, a man and a woman came, and this woman, she took her baby and she laid him in that wood box that's called a manger. And that tree was happy after all because she held a great baby king. Who is that?
Jesus,
yes, baby Jesus. And sometime later, a long, long time later, the second little tree, she got pulled out of her lumber pile, and she was fashioned into just a little boat. She wasn't so big and strong like she wanted to be. She was too little to go on the ocean and sail the waves, but she was put on a little lake. And one day, there's some men, they got in the boat, they were tired, and they got in the boat and they all fell asleep, one of them fell asleep, right? Okay, and soon this big storm come up and the people were afraid. Then one man, he stood up on the boat. Who knows what this man's gonna say? Jaden, what does he say on the storm?
Peace be still.
"Peace, be still," the man said. And soon that little boat, she knew she was carrying the King of Kings, and she was very happy about that. And after a long, long time later, that third tree, she was feeling so sorry for herself. She wanted to be mighty and tall and reach the heavens. But one day she jumped, she was startled. She was yanked out of a wood pile. And then they took and nailed her together. And then they started nailing a man's hands on her. Oh no, and they were even drugged through a crowd, and the crowd was making fun of this man. But on a Sunday morning, when the ground shook and trembled, what happened? Jesus arose from the grave, and in that tree knows she had been able to look to the heavens at all, because every time we look at the cross, who do we think of, guys? Jesus. We think of Jesus. So next time you're not feeling good about yourself, remember, Jesus loves you, and you're special to him. You can go back to your seats. Jamie would come up for special music. Thank you.
Thirsty God, you're the living water. And
Good morning. Happy Sabbath. It's fun to look out this morning at who all is here. One thing I always loved about holidays is we get some people home who otherwise are gone. And so this Sabbath is just the same. I see some new faces. So those of you members who have been around a little while, after church is over, make sure none of our new faces go home without a proper greeting and welcome. Because we have consistently had people just dropping in. So praise God for that. For those of you just dropping in, I hope that you will consider this your church home. A little bit of sobering news before we get started. I was informed that sometime in the night or very early hours of the morning, there was a car accident just right down here at Mukilteo Boulevard where Federal Avenue winds in, and two people lost their lives. So for those of us who frequent this area and that intersection, please be exceedingly careful. It is not a very safe or well-designed intersection. Maybe one of the engineers in this congregation can fix that for us. But anyway, but let's pray this morning as we get going. Lord Jesus, we ask your presence to be in this place today. Lord, I recognize that I cannot say anything of any eternal significance without the quickening of your Holy Spirit speaking through me. So I ask that you would fill me with your Holy Spirit, that you would anoint my lips, that my words would be yours and not mine, that you hide me in the shadow of your cross. We think also of the family grieving the loss of two loved ones today in the accident very close to this congregation. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Amen. While I was on a plane, while I was studying at the seminary, my family had opportunity to go to Idaho and spend about 3 weeks there. But of course, I was a full-time graduate student with a one-week break at the semester. So do you think I got to spend a full 3 weeks in Idaho? No, of course I did not. But I did get to travel by myself without children just this one time on an airplane, which I have to say, going through airport security without little ones is so much easier. Anyway, so I got through security, I got to my plane, I got on the plane, and I was sitting there, and I was reading a book. It was assigned reading. I believe that this was spring break, so it wasn't quite the semester break just yet. And I was reading a book that I needed to write a book review on, and so as I'm reading it, the guy next to me goes, "Are you a Christian?" "Well, yeah, why do you ask?" "Well, the book you're reading, it says, What is truth? Or whatever happened to truth?" And I was like, "Yeah." And he goes, "I also recognize the publisher. That's a Christian publisher, right?" "Yeah." So we start kind of talking about it and dialoguing back and forth about Christianity and this concept of truth and God's truth and biblical truth. Well, the thing that kind of focused our attention was a question asked by the author. And it's a question that's not original to the author, but that originates with Pontius Pilate as he's discussing with Jesus. In John chapter 18, verse 38, Pilate, after listening to Jesus talk about how his kingdom is not of this world, he goes, "What is truth anyway? What is truth?" The editor and the contributing author, Andreas Kostenberger, makes this observation in this book, Whatever Happened to Truth. He says, in fact, through Pilate, the evangelist, that's John, teaches us something quite profound about the connection between Jesus and the truth. Namely, that the more one knows who Jesus is, and Jesus is the truth, the more one must become apathetic about the issue of truth itself, if one is to continue rejecting Jesus. Jesus himself is the truth. And to consistently reject the person of Jesus is to persistently distance yourself from the concept of truth. That's worth considering, isn't it? In a day and age defined by the postmodern approach to truth, where truth is relative, where it's woke to say, "I have my truth and you have yours," or as we hear so often, "You do you, boo." Truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, has given away to half-truths. Sadly, the criteria for something being true has been reduced to whether I like it or not, and if I don't, then it must be fake news. Jesus Christ in Scripture reveals something very different. He reveals himself. In fact, according to the Bible, Jesus himself is the creator of the universe, and thus he is the ultimate reality, the ultimate truth. In fact, the way, the truth, and the life. Everything that we experience from our own existence, the environment that we exist in, to the thoughts and feelings and understandings that we have of everything around us, had to have first existed in the mind of God for us to be able to experience it. Jesus is the ultimate truth. And it is exactly this that Jesus reveals about himself in the formulaic description of himself in this seventh letter to the church of Laodicea found in Revelation. So let's go there. Revelation chapter 3. And I'm going to start reading in verse 14. This is the seventh letter to the church of Laodicea. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. A couple observations about this description of Christ. First, the word Amen. Jesus just says, I am the Amen. The words of the Amen. When we say Amen or Amen, it says in truth, meaning I agree with this thing. In truth, that's what that means. So Jesus says, I am the Amen. That means I am the truth. And he says, I am the faithful and true witness. Truth again. And then he says, I am the beginning, meaning Jesus himself is the creator. This is the seventh and final sermon in this series about the seven churches of Revelation. Again, today we are considering Laodicea, which is known as the lukewarm church. But this notion of truth and Jesus himself as the truth will become very, very important to understanding the message to the church of Laodicea. Now, I hope by now you've picked up that each of these seven messages follow a pattern. In fact, if you pull out the insert in your bulletin, you can see that pattern written out. Now, I've inserted the little thing called historical background, and we just covered the description of Christ, but each one has a description of Christ drawn from the description that John sees in Revelation 1, which has been our scripture reading each and every week of this series. Why do we go back to the same scripture reading over and over and over? Because I want us in our mind to visualize the Jesus who is delivering this message. This is a message direct from the mouth of Jesus himself. Second, there's an appraisal of the church, where Jesus identifies both the good and the bad aspects of the church in question. Third, we find Christ's counsel for each church. What do they need to change? And finally, each church is given a promise to the one who makes the necessary changes. The church of Laodicea is no different. It follows this pattern exactly. So let's dive in. Historical background. What do we know about the city of Laodicea? Well, Laodicea, the city, was a businessman's paradise. You see, they were enormously wealthy. They had a highly successful textile industry where they manufactured, produced, sold, exported black wool. Emphasis on black wool. It was very, very well known. It produced fine garments, and they made an enormous amount of money producing and selling this black wool. They also had a very significant banking industry. People had deposited large sums of money into these banks, and these banks loaned out large sums of money and made quite a bit off of the interest. And they had a very prominent medical school. It was a destination city for many people seeking healing. People would come from far and wide to the medical center of Laodicea to be healed. People came to Laodicea, to the Laodiceans, for healing. They were particularly well known for an eye salve that successfully treated many eye problems back in that day. when the city was severely damaged by an earthquake. The Laodiceans were offered imperial aid. FEMA stepped in and offered them lots of money to repair their city. And they said, "No, thank you, Emperor. We have enough. We will repair our own city. We do not need your aid." Such was the pride that defined the culture of the city of Laodicea. Laodicea. I said it once, now I'm going to do it all the time. So if I keep doing that, just laugh at me and move on. Laodicea. They were known for their pride. Dr. Ronko Stefanovic, in his commentary, The Revelation of Jesus Christ, page 148, he says this: because of its favorable location on the system of Roman roads, the city became one of the greatest commercial and financial centers of the ancient world. Laodicea. I've never done that before, and I got up here, and, you know, you look out at, you know, 180 people and mess something up. That's just the way it is. Laodicea was enormously wealthy and proud of it. The commercial and financial and industrial prosperity and success filled the wealthy citizens of Laodicea with a spirit of pride. End quote. They also had no natural water supply. There was no river or stream that supplied the city with water. And so they had a 6-mile-long aqueduct from a neighboring city's hot springs. And they piped the water in through the aqueduct into the city. By the time the water reached the city of Laodicea, it was lukewarm. It was no longer hot, but it definitely was not cold. So that is the historical background. Now the appraisal. I would like to point out that Jesus has nothing good to say to Laodicea. Nothing good. Revelation chapter 3, verse 15. "I know your works. You are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So, because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, 'I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing,' not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked." Jesus has nothing good to say about Laodicea. He doesn't point out any particular sin, no particular heresy that they're involved in. But they get the most scathing rebuke of any of the seven churches. Jesus says that because they are lukewarm, he will spew them out of his mouth. Why? What's so bad about being lukewarm, you might ask? Aside from being metaphorical imagery drawn directly from Laodicea's actual circumstances, lukewarm water is not really good for much of anything. It does not refresh those who are hot and thirsty, nor does it have any healing properties that a natural hot springs would possess. It's lukewarm, kind of useless. Ellen White explains the problem with lukewarm Christians in equally harsh terms. She says, "It would be more pleasing to the Lord if lukewarm professors of religion had never named his name. They are a continual weight to those who would be faithful followers of Jesus. They are a stumbling block to unbelievers." You see, they don't add anything good to what it means to be a Christian, but they definitely tarnish the name. As Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:15, they have a form of godliness but are denying its power. These are Christians who are Christians in name only. Maybe they go to church. Maybe they hold an office. Maybe they don't. Maybe they say they go to church, but don't. These are Christians, dare I say, Seventh-day Adventists, who enjoy all the cultural and social aspects of church life, but if you were to do an audit of their lives, there is no vital connection to Jesus Christ. No life-changing connection. They do not abide in Jesus, and they certainly bear no fruit. Why would someone want to become a Christian? Why would someone want to become a Seventh-day Adventist Christian if the professed Adventists or Christians don't have anything different than those in the world? If there's no value added by their religion, why should I even care? These people act and speak and do exactly the same things I do. Their life doesn't seem to be any different. Why would I need their religion? They don't seem to have any more joy or happiness or peace. They don't have anything I don't already have. You see, these Laodicean Christians suffer from bad cases of overconfidence and self-deception. This is why it's so important that Jesus is the truth, because they are deceiving themselves. What they say to themselves is not true at all. Verse 17, "For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked." Because they have no need in life, it's easy to fall into the self-deceptive mindset. If I need nothing in my external life, then I need nothing in my spiritual life. Sure, they give lip service to their spiritual need, because that's what you do as Christians, right? Oh, yes, we need Jesus. But nothing about the way they live or behave proves their statement to be true. Deep down, they're still in love with the world, and their success in life has masked their abject spiritual poverty. But Scripture says something very different. Scripture says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It does not matter how educated or uneducated you are, you have fallen short of the glory of God and need Jesus Christ as your Savior. Amen. It does not matter how large or small your bank account is, you have fallen short and you need Jesus Christ as your Savior. It does not matter if you are the CEO or the janitor, you have fallen short and you need Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. It does not matter if you were born on this continent or the continent to the south or the continent across the ocean or out in the middle of the ocean somewhere. You've fallen short and you need Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Until we realize that, we have no hope whatsoever, and this is exactly the thing that the church of Laodicea has missed. So my wife and I enjoy watching some of these cooking competition shows. It's kind of fun. These people get together and they compete. They have a, you know, short span of time to cook this wonderful dish, and then the judges ream them out at the end of it, and it's kind of fun. And occasionally somebody hits a home run, and it makes for some pretty entertaining TV. Well, nothing drives me more crazy than the person who thinks their food is good when it's actually terrible. There was one gal on one of these shows that we're kind of working our way through, and she goes, "I don't know what the judges are saying, but my food tastes good." And all the judges were like, "This is terrible." Can't hear an assessment of themselves. Totally deceived, totally unteachable, untrainable, can't grow or mature in any way with an attitude like that. That's Laodicea. "For we say, we are rich, we have prospered, and we need nothing." That is Laodicea. Listen to Dr. Stefanovich again. He says, "The fact that they," the Laodiceans, "are free from apostasy or heresy, that no serious sin is found among them, that they have a positive opinion of themselves, is not a guarantee of their relationship with Jesus Christ. Your life on the outside might look really good. You might have it all together. Nope, no affair. We're not having any other major ethical issues. We're just lackadaisically going through life. Not having some overt, correctable sin in your life does not mean that you have a vital connection with Jesus Christ. Sin isn't just an action or a series of actions. It's the state we're born into. And until we recognize that, we've got problems. But Jesus is the truth. Jesus himself exposes the self-deception, and he accurately diagnoses our problem. Do you ever notice what happens in Scripture when the glory of God is revealed to a human being? Think about it. What happens? They immediately prostrate themselves on the ground with their face hidden because they can't stand to be in the presence of one who is holy, because it immediately reveals what? Their own sinfulness. What does Isaiah say in chapter 6? Oh, woe is me, for I am a man undone. This is the guy God is choosing to take his message to the people of the world. And he's like, nope, can't do it. I'm out. Bows down in front with his face to the ground. Jesus exposes that self-deception, accurately diagnoses the situation, but he also brings the remedy. Let's move on to the counsel to the church, starting in verse 18. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. Now, did you pick up all the irony that's loaded into these verses? We went through this historical description of the church of Laodicea, just the city of Laodicea, and we find out that they're enormously wealthy, probably a repository for huge amounts of gold. And they sell black garments, and they sell eye salve. And what are the things Jesus points out to them? First, buy from me gold refined by the fire. I watched a video about how gold is refined this last week. You all probably know this already, but it's worth revisiting. In order for gold to be refined, it has to be melted. And the only way to melt it is to burn it in an extremely hot fire. And they put it into something they call a crucible. Think about that term. How else do we use the term crucible? I'll let you work that one out. They put the gold into the crucible, and then they put the crucible into the fire, and then the impurities, the dross as it's called, comes to the surface and it's wiped away, it's scraped away. And then, and only then, after it's been melted down to its most basic elements and the impurities have been taken away because it's been forged in fire, then it can be made into something of value. Then it can be formed into something truly valuable. The word refined in Scripture comes from the Greek word puro, puro or puros, and it means to be tried, to be set on fire, to be burned. And it's typically used of metal. But another interesting thing about the word puro is that it always occurs in the passive voice. What's the difference between active and passive voice, you might ask? Well, I had to study Greek and Hebrew to learn this. I know I was taught by my wonderful English teachers all along the way, but I totally forgot. But active voice means I am the subject and I act upon the object. So, I am the subject. I read the Bible. Active voice. I am doing the action. Passive voice is where you flip that around and the Bible becomes the subject. The Bible was read by Pastor Ryan. The Bible is receiving the action. Active and passive. Well, in order for something to be refined, it always happens in the passive. It has to be burned by something else. Jesus says, buy from me gold refined by the fire. You need that gold in your life. So, how do we buy gold refined by the fire? Next, Jesus counsels the Laodiceans to purchase white garments. Remember, Laodicea was famous for producing black garments and black wool. And Jesus is saying, no. You're trusting in yourself. You're trusting in your own riches, the things that you do really well. That's not what you need. You need white garments to cover your spiritual nakedness. Revelation 7, verse 13 and 14. Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come? John says. And he said to me, these are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. How do we get white robes? We go and we dip it in the blood of Jesus. And the next morning we wake up and we realize it's not clean anymore. And so we have to dip it again in the blood of Jesus. And maybe later in that afternoon we realize our robe's not clean again. And so we have to dip it in the blood of Jesus. And the next morning we get up and we have to dip our robe over and over and over and over and over in the blood of Jesus. Because sin isn't just an action. Sin is the state we were born in. And we all, every single one of us, is dependent on dipping our robe every single day into the blood of Jesus Christ to be washed. Buy from me gold refined in the fire. Buy from me white garments. And then he says, buy from me salve to anoint your eyes. Laodicea, again, was famous for selling this eye salve that in a day when medical science was not that advanced, they had a medicine that could cure some common eye ailments. They were accustomed to people coming to them and paying them money for them to dispense the medicine to provide the cure. They were the ones doing the curing. And Jesus says, no. That's not how this works. You are the ones who are blind. Matthew 13, verse 15, for this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and with their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. Jesus is saying, you need eye salve for me so that you can see your true spiritual condition, so that you will turn to me because I am the only source of healing. I loved Jamie's song earlier because if you could summarize our response to the message of Laodicea, it's that we need Jesus. We need Jesus. That's the conclusion we need to come to. At the end of all of it, do we come to the conclusion way deep down inside of ourselves that we need Jesus? How do we buy eye salve from Christ? The fact that we're instructed to buy indicates that it costs us something. But isn't salvation free? That's a good question, I think. It's costing us something. We have to buy it, but isn't salvation free? I would say it is free. If we, torn down to our sinful, repentant selves, come to Jesus Christ, salvation is free. But you see, we like to put a lot of things in between us and Christ. Pride and self-sufficiency. You see, we all, deep down, because it's part of human nature, we hold on to this idea that eventually I'll get to the point where I won't need to dip my robe every morning in the blood of Jesus Christ. Eventually I'll have enough victory that I'll just be good enough that I don't have to rely on that anymore and I'll be okay. Which it couldn't be further from the truth. But we all hold on in our pride, in our sinful pride, to this mistaken notion. Does it cost us something? Yes, it does. It costs us our pride and our self-deception and our self-sufficiency. It's going to cost us. We have to pay our pride and lay it away, lay it aside, and then we can purchase what Jesus offers, the healing Jesus offers. So how do we buy these things? Verse 19, Revelation 3, verse 19. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. Now, before we can really wrestle with that, I think we need a little more scripture under our belt. So go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 32. Paul is speaking. He says, but when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that, this is why, that we may not be condemned along with the world. When God disciplines us, it's to save us. so that we will not be condemned. Discipline leads to redemption. Job chapter 5, verse 17, blessed is the one whom God reproves. Therefore, despise not the discipline of the Almighty. Hebrews chapter 12, starting in verse 5, my son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by him. For the Lord disciplines the one he loves and chastises every son whom he receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons and daughters. For what son or daughter is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline in which all others have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? Verse 10, for they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good, that we may share his holiness. Verse 11, for the moment all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. If you want to see eternity, you must submit to the discipline of the Lord. Because God does adopt us. He calls us sons and he calls us daughters, but he also disciplines legitimate children. What does that mean? The word discipline comes from paideia in Greek, paideia. And that is the exact same root as the word paidagogos, which is teacher. The same root. To discipline is to teach or to train. So one definition of discipline or paideia, the whole training and education of children, which relates to the cultivation of mind and morals and employs for this purpose now commands and admonitions, reproof and punishment. Second definition, whatever in adults also cultivates the soul, especially by correcting mistakes and curbing the passions. Instruction which aims at the increase of virtue. We take discipline and we immediately assume a negative. But discipline has more, a broader range of meaning than just punishment, though it certainly includes punishment. But not all discipline is bad. So on the punitive side, examples of the punitive side of discipline for children, spankings, timeout, being grounded, extra chores, you know, removal of privileges, things of that nature. For adults in the criminal sense, jail time, community service, restitution, all examples of discipline. How might God discipline, punish us? I believe difficult circumstances in our life may be one legitimate way God would punish us. Think about what happened in Elijah's day. I've been reading through Prophets and Kings and reading through Elijah, and Elijah is sent to a nation that has completely abandoned God, even though they bear God's name. They have taken down all of God's altars. They have eroded the temple, and they've set up false idols and false altars, and they're worshiping in horrendous ways. And Elijah is sent to them, and God says through Elijah, you will have a drought until I relinquish it. That's pretty punitive, I think. They can't get it. They can't figure it out. And so God says, until you recognize what you are doing wrong, you are going to be under punishment, direct from God. God is looking for a decided change in behavior. My wife and I, coming back from seminary, had quite a bit of debt, and I was pretty stressed out by it. My wife would say that she was not nearly as stressed out about it as I was, but I was really stressed out about it. It was a little over $80,000 in consumer debt, and we didn't make nearly that much in an annual basis, and it was something that really stressed me out, and I thought, I'm too smart to be this in debt. I need to be better at this. This is not working. And so learned a lot of principles of money management and good budgeting and all of these kinds of things. And praise God, within 3 years, we had paid all of that off. Now, there, God worked some magic in there to make the numbers work. It wasn't just us. But God uses circumstances, things that feel like punishment, to push you and cause you to make a change that you would not have otherwise made. You see, if we'd earned enough money to just easily survive with that level of debt, we probably never would have made that change. We would have just existed with problems. But God pushed really deep and hard and said, you need to make this change. Other major difficulties in life circumstances can also come from God. I'm not saying that all of them do. We'll talk about that in just a second. But some major things, I believe, can come from God to teach us to depend upon Him, to erode our confidence in ourselves. Things like major health issues and death, foreclosures, loss of job, all of these things can and sometimes do come from God as punishment to train us, as discipline to help us stop relying on ourselves and to rely on God. Because our success in this earth is not God's motivation, it's our existence in eternity. Our name written in the Lamb's Book of Life is God's motivation, not our success here. And if He has to take away our success here to get our name written there, He's going to do it. I knew a man named Gordy out in Forks. And Gordy had been one of those strong, aggressive men who liked to just go out in the wilderness and live life to the fullest. He'd take his ATV and he would just go on his four-wheeler, going as fast as he could up logging roads and trails and all kinds of other places. One of those types of people that John Anholm and I almost get run over by when we're running out by his place. And Gordy just lived life right on the edge. He was going 1,000 miles an hour until he rolled his four-wheeler and went 30 or 40 feet down the side of an embankment and broke dozens of bones in his body. And God held him just short of being paralyzed. But he was never going to be able to care for himself, live on his own, anything like that. He was not paralyzed, but he was totally disabled and dependent for the rest of his life. I met him some 25, 30 years later, and he said, that was the best thing that ever happened to me. I'm looking at him going, please, God, don't let me come to that point. Please don't let that be the thing that I need for salvation. I would not wish that on anyone. He says, it was the best thing that happened to me because I never had time for God. And when I was laid up in the hospital for months and months and then months and months of rehab and then just not able to do much of anything because he walks around with a cane very slowly, surely is spry compared to Gordy. Love having you up here singing today. Happy birthday again, Shirley. Gordy said, it's the best thing because I took the time to get to know Jesus, and now that is more important and more valuable to me than all of those other things I did in life ever were. If God has to use it, He will. But a note of caution. We are at war. So please don't interpret every bad thing that happens to you as God trying to train you or that it comes direct from God, because that does damage to God's character. We are at war, and Satan is involved in this thing too. We call that the great controversy. God is not the cause of all difficult circumstances, but God can and does utilize these circumstances for our training. You see, God's discipline exposes our insufficiency and teaches us to trust in His all-sufficiency. Laodicea is rich and delusional. They think they need nothing. God says, watch this. When we willingly submit to discipline, incredible things can happen in our life. Self-discipline. When we willingly submit to a plan, when we say, you know, I'm not so good at managing my own weight. I'm not so good at choosing the food and the portions, and I'd like to lose weight. If we submit ourselves to a proven plan, we can get control. Finances are the same thing. I'm not so good at that. We have to admit that. We submit ourselves to a proven plan, and we can get control. Our spiritual life is exactly the same. There are certain things that we can do that help us to grow. We open this book every day and reflect on a passage of it. Read it very carefully and ask God, what does this mean for me today? We would call that reflecting on Scripture. We would also include in this Scripture memorization. Taking one passage and learning it very, very well and reciting it to ourselves throughout a day. That is something that is proven to draw us closer to God. Prayer, including just, you know, common prayer that we might have, say, in our own time, prayer at meals, things like prayer walking and prayer journaling and intercessory prayer, and even praying scripture, other proven things that help bring us closer to God. But we have to submit ourselves to the plan. We have to just be willing to engage the process, not invent something new or profound, but engage the process. Things like fasting, unplugging from all of the devices and things that we have, and just sitting in the silence. The stillness makes the voice of God grow more distinct. Attending corporate worship on a regular basis. Engaging in stewardship, asking God, how can I better manage the things that you have given to me? And making changes. And service, things like picking up trash, reading to young people over at the school. All kinds of other service opportunities. When we submit ourselves to a proven plan, that is called self-discipline, and it produces a harvest of righteousness. James chapter 1, verse 2, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 11, for the moment all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Jesus counsels us, buy from me gold refined in the fire. Buy from me white garments. Buy from me eyesalve. How do we do that? We allow ourselves to submit to the discipline God offers. And then the last bit of the counsel, so be zealous and repent. This means a decided turning point. I am no longer content with the way things are, and I am going to turn here and now decidedly once and for all. Because in verse 20, Revelation 3, verse 20, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. You see, there's good news, friends. Jesus didn't go away. Just because we didn't realize he was there all along, just because we didn't realize our need, he didn't go away. He's still there. He still wants to come in. He says, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. But the thing is Jesus will never force his way in. He may cause a water main to burst. He might even, you know, send up some smoke signals. He might cause an accident out in front. I don't know. But he won't force his way in. We have to open the door. And then in the ancient world, one of the most intimate things people could do together was eat. To eat with someone, to share a table and to break bread together was one of the most intimate things people could do. And Jesus says, I want that intimacy with you. I want that kind of relationship. I want to spend that close, personal, familial time with you. And the promise to the overcomer, the one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. In the ancient Near East, thrones were more like couches. Now we picture it more of like a chair Santa sits in at the mall. It's this big chair, and, you know, the one person sits on it all by themselves. That's a very Western way of looking at it. But in the ancient Near East, it was much more like a couch that multiple people could be on. And Jesus says, if you conquer, if you overcome, if you make the changes necessary, if you realize your abject spiritual poverty and rely completely and totally on me, then you get to sit on my throne with me, right there with the Father. You get to be with me. You see, all of the promises to all of the seven churches are incorporated in this one promise. To be right there with Jesus on his throne means complete and utter victory. Jesus can completely win the war, but he won't force himself on us. So, will we hear, will the Forest Park Church hear the message that Jesus has to the church of Laodicea? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we want to be there on that throne with you. We want to sit down there. That moment when you've placed a crown on our head, when you have said the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your master," and you invite us to come there and sit with you on that throne. Lord Jesus, we want that to be our experience. But help us to realize that all of the things, all of the good in this world is not our eternal destiny. And you can give and you can take it all away. But the real point, the real purpose is that we will submit ourselves completely and totally to you, that we will trust in your cross and the gift you gave us there, that we will dip our robes in your blood and make them white every single day, and that will be the first, foremost, and always action of our life, the always focus of our life. And Lord, we ask that from this, our great life work, our career, our finances, all of those things would just witness to this one great work of salvation that you have done for us, that we would not be like the church of Laodicea, thinking that we are rich and have prosperous ease and we are in need of nothing. Lord, let us always recognize our need, and in trusting you to satisfy that need, that we would be there with you in eternity. This is our prayer, dear Jesus. Amen.
Amen. When you reach 85, you've seen a lot and learned a lot. And everything Ryan said is just, when you live these many years and you're always looking for the for that happily ever after, it's not here, it's there. We can live happily in the Lord and be happy in him, but that's where happiness and contentment and peace is in Jesus, and looking forward to his coming. So we're going to sing our closing song here, and it's "Let All Things Now Living Praise God." Let all things now living.
Please stand.
Yes. And
who guided the sun to
May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for joining us. If you would like to learn about the opportunities available through Forest Park Seventh-day Adventist Church, such as outreach, service, and Forest Park Adventist Christian School, visit this website. If you are in our area, we would be delighted to have you worship with us at this address.